Hello and welcome back to the Healthcare Uncomplicated YouTube channel. I'm delighted to have you here again. Make sure you follow all the previous content, so subscribe to the channel and share this amazing content with your communities in healthcare. And today I have another leader and inspiring guest for you. We have Zeev Neuwirth. He's a physician executive, an author, speaker, and a podcast host. Zeev, how are you?
Good, João. Thank you so much for having me on. Such a pleasure to finally meet you after corresponding for so long.
Brilliant. I'm delighted to have you here and I follow your work and I'm glad that we make it and we are here together this time.
Thanks, João.
And today we are here to discuss the topic transforming healthcare beyond the walls. Yeah. And the first question for you, Zeev, is what do you think it can be done realistically to fix healthcare and transform healthcare?
Yeah, so João, I love your question. And at the same time, I think we have to be very, very careful about what we mean by realistically, because, you know, I think in the past, even up to the present time, realistic means incremental changes, small changes that will take years and years. And while that's been the way healthcare has been developing, now the delivery of healthcare, there are amazing leaps in medical technology, in medical science, brilliant leaps, I would say, brilliant transformations. But in the actual delivery of healthcare, the way people receive healthcare in this country and across the world, it's been very, very slow to change. And in fact, one could argue that despite all the brilliant science and technology, healthcare today is more complicated, more confusing, more costly, and from a quality and safety perspective, no better off than it's been in the past. And there's a lot of evidence to support that. You know that, I know that, I'm happy to go through that. But the point is this, I have been looking at studying for the past few years, it's now almost 10 years, people who didn't accept and still don't accept what we call realistic. And not they are not talking about it, they're not analyzing it, they are actually building a more humanistic healthcare system. And I literally have hundreds and hundreds of these examples, and they're not small. Some of these examples literally are being deployed nationally, where people are bending the curve, where they're really transforming healthcare. And what I've done in the latest book that I've published called Beyond the Walls, what I've done is to distill these examples, these exemplars, into three major domains, three major strategies that I believe are absolutely necessary to be done together if we are going to transform healthcare. And the alternative, quite honestly, João, the alternative is not pretty. The alternative is the reality that we don't want to be in the next 5 to 10 years, because it's a reality that we're looking at, which is our lifespan is decreasing. Chronic disease is epidemic. People aren't, you know, half of Americans have hypertension, and over half of those, the hypertension is not controlled. Diabetes is even worse. Heart failure is much worse than that. Access, affordability. I mean, João, over 100 million Americans, 100 million are in medical debt, and a significant percentage of them will never get out of medical debt. All it takes is one hospitalization, one major chronic disease, and a family, an American family, will be in debt for years. So this is a reality that is actually not, it's not static, it's actually getting worse. And so I think we're at a moment in time where we have to change what we think about realistic. We have to, you know, it's great for leaders to talk about slow change, incrementalism, you know, things take time. That's great if you're the CEO and you've got lots of money, or you're in the C-suite and you've got lots of money. Most Americans don't have that. I'll tell you something, João. When you're a family member and you're sitting in an emergency room with your child, and they are sitting there for days because they can't be seen for their psychiatric issues and they can't find placement. And by the way, this is the norm for a child to be sitting for days in emergency rooms waiting to be placed somewhere. And it doesn't matter, you know, who you are. For the vast majority of Americans, when you're sitting there in a clinical exam room with your parent and shaking your head because you can't get the care, or you yourself. I can't tell you, João, how many doctors, nurses, people in healthcare who've come up to me over the last few months as I've been going around the country speaking about the Beyond the Walls transformation of American healthcare. How many healthcare workers, how many physicians, nurses, PAs, health tech, I mean, consultants have literally said, Zeev, I wouldn't have believed it until I ended up, you know, on the other side of the stethoscope, until I was a patient, and I couldn't believe how frustrating it was. I had to give up my job. I couldn't find the doctors and nurses I needed. This is the reality. And quite honestly, João, we can't accept it. And when you ask, you know, what can we realistically do? I can go on and on and give you example after example of what people, I'm not thinking this, it is actually happening. And what we need to do is we need to adopt it and we need to spread it because it's already being done. And we need to be part of that.
Yeah, Zeev, thank you so much. I mean, you mentioned some really important things there. You mentioned the system is very complicated. I actually try to do the opposite and unveil an uncomplicated healthcare. But also I can hear your passion, but also the frustration in the unfair system. I mean, when you mention 100 million people are in medical debt, that's very significant. Like 1/3 of the population, probably nearly half of the adult population in the United States. So it's a lot of different
things.
Right. And I hear your frustration about things moving really slow. The system is not fit for purpose, of course. Yeah. Moving on. Mm-hmm. What other key steps can be taken to existing challenges in reframe healthcare?
Yeah. Well, so maybe let me share with you the three domains that I've talked about in the book and Beyond the Walls. And again, this is distilled from 10 years of not studying the problem, but studying entrepreneurs and leaders who are actually creating solutions. And so this is my methodology, and it's quite different. I've been sort of an anthropologist or ethnographer looking at leaders who are actually transforming healthcare. This is the world I've immersed myself in. I don't know anyone else who has done what I've done, and I've done it for 10 years now, almost 10 years. And what I'm seeing is there are three major domains. There is the digital revolution, which most people don't understand, is literally transforming it's clearly transforming our lives, but it is transforming healthcare. And by digital, I mean the digitization and analytics. That's really what's happening. It's not just telemedicine or virtual visits. That's just an example, but it's really the digitization. So it's that digital transformation. On the other end of it is the business model transformation. And most people, including most leaders in healthcare, are totally unaware of the business model transformation. This is platforms, this is new partnerships, new collaborations that are unprecedented in the market. Now, those two strategies support the third strategy, which is the humanism revolution. Right now in healthcare, we have racism, sexism, ageism, ableism, reductionism. Those are all the isms that are rife, that are systemic in our system and structural. They're built into the system. What we need to do, what people are doing, is replacing it with humanism. So those are the three domains: the digital revolution, the business model revolution, and the humanism revolution. Now, the great news is we don't have to make anything up. We don't have to create anything. We don't have to build anything. There are so many examples of entrepreneurs and leaders, and I give dozens and dozens of them in the book and hundreds of my talks, where literally we can start to look at what is successfully working and we can actually bring it into our organizations. We could adopt it, we could adapt it, we can resource it and scale it. And thankfully, that is actually what's happening. So one example, just to be very concrete, senior care is abysmal in our country and it's getting worse, despite the fact that the fastest growing segment of the population are seniors. And I'm not talking about over 65, I'm talking about over 75 or over 80. It is the fastest growing segment of the population. These people have tremendous chronic diseases. Obviously, you know, dementia and cognitive impairment is rampant. There's a tremendous need. The system isn't built for it, except for entrepreneurs and leaders who have specifically created amazing, customized, personalized, cost-effective strategies like ChenMed and Iora Health and Humana Center Well and Oak Street. These, they have been honing these business models and clinical care models literally for years, if not decades. And we don't have to make it up. We don't have to build it. We can if we want. We could copy it and adapt it ourselves. But an example is Walmart. Walmart, instead of trying to recreate senior care, is literally buying ChenMed. They're in the middle of this process. I don't know if it's going to go through or not, but CVS did it with Oak Street. Humana purchased senior care clinics that were existing and put it together into its CenterWell brand. Optum did the same thing. They purchased Landmark and other existing NaviHealth, other existing entities that had already perfected the senior care. So again, it's tactical. It is strategic and tactical. But when you ask the question, is it realistic? Not only is it realistic, it's actually happening. But I think most leaders are not aware of the context of the big picture. And again, that's my message. I'm trying to make it simple and clear and doable. And that's what I lay out in this book, Beyond the Walls, and in my talks and presentations to boards and C-suites.
Brilliant. Zeev, thank you so much. I mean, you mentioned so much in there, and it's also senior care around the world is, they say it's really a major issue.
And Joel,
let
me give you one example, concrete, women's health. Right now, there are 60 million women in menopause age in the United States, 60 million. That's more than double the number of people who have diabetes. There isn't a solution out there to help them with menopause. Good luck with going to your primary care doctor, your OB-GYN, you will get the runaround. You will be sent to psychiatrists and neurologists and endocrinologists. And there are now specific offerings out there that have been built by experts. They're not as good. They're better than anything else we've had before to help women with menopausal symptoms. State of the art, the best in class, virtual even. So you don't even have to go anywhere. Yeah. An example is a company called MIDI, M-I-D-I, but that's just one of dozens of women's health organizations. These leaders, these entrepreneurs have created a whole new ecosystem of care just around women. And again, hospital systems, payers, you don't have to build it or create it yourself. You can work with these folks and actually get the care that women need. So again, I just given you two, senior care and women's health. So many more examples of people who are realistically, actually, tangibly creating a new healthcare that is available for, I mean, there's no reason why payers, why the government cannot adopt these and adapt these, resource them and spread them. And again, I have many, many more examples.
Yeah, innovation is there. Thank you so much for mentioning that. And in your book, Beyond the Walls, you attempted to transform the American healthcare system by covering megatrends, movements, and disruptors, as you mentioned, innovators there. Can you expand a little on that, please?
Yeah. So the megatrend really is the digital revolution. The humanistic trend is what I've just been sharing with you, I think, in terms of caring for seniors, caring for women, even the notion of contextual care. You know, right now, people are still very much treated like widgets. And again, I just want to be very clear, this is not about the doctors and nurses and staff in healthcare. The people in healthcare are amazing. This is about the system. The system is an industrial factory model. And you have to fight it so hard to not be that, but you're going to lose. And that's why we have to change the system. And that's what these people are doing. The VA in the United States has created a whole person healthcare program that they're deploying, where they ask, and this becomes part of the actual healthcare. They not only ask, what's the matter with you? They ask, what matters to you? That has become embedded in the visit, embedded in the whole system. So and they have a way of asking it, they have options. Okay, what's important to you? And the reason they did that is because they realized this is 20, 25 years of research they've done and deployment to come to this point, this whole person health movement. They realized that people are human beings. They have a consciousness, they have a soul. If you don't understand their purpose, if you don't understand their meaning in life, if you just say, take this medication, they're not robots, they're not machines. You have to talk to the purpose and meaning, and you have to connect to that. Otherwise, nothing else matters. And that question, what matters to you, has become the central focal point of a whole new system of healthcare. And this isn't a pilot program. They are literally deploying this across the entire country. Not only that, the National Institute of Medicine has done, it's got a new name now, but it used to be called the Institute of Medicine. And they have done a 406-page report. It was published in January, looking at the VA's whole health movement and recommending to Congress that this should be deployed not only within the VA, outside of the VA, to every healthcare system in the United States of America, and it should be studied and researched. And wow. So, you know, João, so this is what's happening. Again, I have so many more examples of this. The business model transformation is the one that I think most people in healthcare, the leaders, really don't understand because no one's really explained it. And again, that's why I wrote the book. There's a whole third section. That's part three, is about the business transformation. Look, Amazon, an example. Amazon is a technology, but it's a new business model. The business model is called a platform. A platform is not, the old business model is you make something, you know, from resources and then you sell it. This model, there's no making. It's literally on your platform, you bring the services, the vendors, okay? And you bring the customers, and your platform connects those two. That's what a platform business model is. It is a revolutionary model, which again, Airbnb, you know, we're looking at Uber, Lyft, obviously Amazon. These are examples of platform business models. Four of the five largest companies in the world right now, four out of five of the largest companies are platform business models. Platforms have already entered into healthcare. There are numerous examples of platforms now delivering healthcare. We need to understand that. We need to actually get into that game. I think that healthcare systems, hospital systems have a role, whether they play the major platform or they're sitting in a platform, but you have to understand those business models. You have to understand the new partnerships and collaborations that are happening that are unprecedented. And again, you know, again, this is very concrete. This is not hypothetical. This is not theoretical. This is, and it didn't just happen last year. It's been happening for over a decade. Yeah.
Thank you, Zeev. That's a brilliant overview. And also I like that the thinking around disrupting the business models, and they are, everything is evolving. One last item to round up the interview. I'm looking for a short answer now. How can we make healthcare uncomplicated?
You can't fight the existing model. I don't believe you can do that. In fact, you know, the scientists have said that, you know, for years, and the business gurus, the way you create something new is by creating something new that is easier, more effective, simpler. So rather than trying to unravel the complexity of what exists, my recommendation is we start to build a new healthcare system, that the old one. And that's what I see happening. If you look at the history of politics, the history of science, you don't fight the old system, you just make it irrelevant. And that's what I've been studying, and that's what the book's about, and that's what my recommendation would be.
Brilliant. It's a fantastic way to round up. Zeev, thank you so much for these amazing insights, your passion, your expertise, and also your years of work in bringing everything together. Now, these recommendations, these insights. Thank you so much for accepting my invite. I'm going to round up the interview now.
Thank you, Shiraz. What a pleasure speaking to you and finally getting a chance to see you.
Yeah, brilliant. To all our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, I'm going to post Zeev's contact details in here, his LinkedIn, Twitter, and also the links to the important books. Make sure you check him out and also connect with him. Make a connection. As you can see, he's truly passionate about healthcare, and I'll see you all next time.